Hey Ryan, how's it going?
All good. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Sweet. Cool.
My plan was to just do audio, but since you're on the screen and you're looking good, we might as well just carry on with video if you want to.
Yeah, that's fine by me.
Yeah, that's great. Hey, this is episode one.
Thanks for having me, man.
Yeah, you're welcome. Thanks for doing it. And my intention with this is just to keep it really relaxed and conversational and kind of if
I've got
that.
a beer. I'm ready for that. That's
Oh,
fine.
cool. Yeah, I don't have any particular outcome for this. There's nothing I'm trying to promote or sell. I don't really care. I'm just looking to just have interesting conversations and hear what you've been up to.
Okay.
So catch it. It's been a couple of years since I've seen you.
Yeah, we met up in Bristol. At the time, I think you'd only pretty much just started doing your handstand classes, I think.
Yeah, that was at least 2 or 3 years ago, I reckon.
And yeah, I just wanted to catch up with you at that time, just to see how you were doing as well. You're a pretty interesting guy on Facebook. Yeah, all is well, man.
Well, in that time, it's really weird. At the moment, I'm actually getting fed up with handstands, and
Yeah.
I'm kind of going through a transition.
But you've moved, haven't you? You've moved to Wales or something, and
Almost, yeah. Next week I am. I'm going to Wales, sort of. Just to, yeah, kind of. Well, I guess you know what it's like moving to a new place. You've moved to Germany, haven't you? So,
yeah.
it's kind of like that desire for a fresh start and just to kind of wipe the slate clean and all that kind of thing. And tell me, what's the latest news? What's your current projects then?
Okay, well, yeah, I'm living in Munich. I've been here for a couple of years, and I've just finished a teaching term of my guitar groups. I teach like four people at a time, beginners, just how to just to get started on the guitar. It's usually in like an 8 week course.
Oh, I see.
So I've just finished that term, and basically through January, I'm just going to be planning on using this new camera that I've got here to make some YouTube videos and get ready for what's kind of be coming up in the next year. I'm off to Austria. I'm going to be doing some gigs out there for a month, and then I'm going to Mauritius, and then I'm going to Amsterdam, then I'm going to Morocco, I think, and going to just keep doing as much traveling as I can next year.
So, from what I can tell, you perform as a solo act, right?
Mostly, but I do also work. I have worked in the past with a violinist quite regularly. And I'm hoping now with I have some new songs. I'm recording a new album, so I'm hoping to put together a kind of band, more acoustic based, not with a full drum set maybe, but with a cajon and a violin, as well as another guitar, harmonies and all that sort of stuff.
It strikes me, I would imagine that doing it as a solo act keeps things very simple in terms of like traveling and booking things. I mean, I used to play in bands and I got really overwhelmed with the complication of trying to collaborate with five or six other people and travel together and make sure everyone's available for rehearsals. For me, it kind of spiraled out of control. It stressed me out and I gave up. So, like, where is that balance for you?
I know what you mean. I saw you play. What was it? It was a funk band, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was a cheesy covers funk band with Matt Baker.
What was the band called?
Funky Dory.
Funky Dory. That's the one. Yeah, cool. I know exactly what you're saying about being in a band. It is hard work. There's a lot of personal dynamics going on. Scheduling. Everybody's got to be as interested in the project as you are. And sometimes you just can't rely on people, and it's not necessarily their fault or whatever. But being a solo artist is much easier in regards to traveling, for sure. You only have to pay one plane ticket. You only split the money one way, all these sorts of things. But playing music with other people is by far the more rewarding experience. And I wish I could do it more, but I just know that I can't. I can't currently find these gigs where I can actually pay five or six musicians well enough to do it. But that would definitely be my goal moving forward.
I'm curious about the business side of it in terms of like when you book dates or whatever you call it. Do you book it all up yourself? Is there some kind
There's
of a
something
floating?
going on with your microphone. It's gone really
All right. Tell me.
garlicky.
How is it? Can you hear
Yeah.
me now?
I
Is it
can hear you,
still?
but it's repeating and it's distorted.
Oh, weird. This new mic I bought just now. Hang on a sec. Like, is it still bad, Ryan?
It's better.
Hey, just try switching off your video just on the off chance that that might speed up.
Goodbye.
I don't know if it'll make a difference. Is that any better?
I can hear you better now. I don't know if the video had anything to do with it, but it's fine. You don't need my face in there anyway.
Yeah, that's fine. Let's stick to audio. That's fine. I'm not sure exactly how it works, but I don't know if it makes any difference. So I'm wondering, from a business side of it and booking up dates and stuff, because even though I'm not a musician, when I do my handstand workshops around the country, it's kind of similar to a kind of tour. You know, I book the venue myself, I do the marketing myself, I do the ticket sales myself. I choose to do it all myself. And how does that work for you? Is it the same?
I don't get to do tours as such, but yeah, like if I'm doing some gigs abroad, for example, then it all started off actually when I was playing in Corfu one time, and then from there I got some gigs in Austria, and that led to Australia later. But like, for example, when I was in Australia, I just like visited some open mic nights, made some contacts with some musicians, and then played some venues here and there and sold a couple of CDs. You have to do most of it yourself at the moment as well. I do have like a manager stroke booking agent who's helping me to book a tour next year. And that takes off a lot of the stress. I can't imagine how you manage to do everything for yourself. It is quite a lot of work, isn't it? And
yeah, it's a lot of work. I manage to keep it pretty efficient. I try and keep it. I mean, when I book up my handstand workshops, I'll book about 10 to 20 in a go. So I'll sit there and just contact village halls or fitness studios or leisure centres and just, you know, make booking inquiries and book up the studios. So I do all that in one go. And then the way I do it, I use Facebook ads to target adverts, because you can target it very specifically at each region. So I've got all my adverts, and then let's say I'm teaching in London, Birmingham and Brighton or whatever, I can just target the ads at those locations in the 4 weeks leading up. So I've got it pretty slick and pretty like as efficient as I possibly can, if that makes sense. So are you, is it making life easier for you then, working with a booker?
Yeah, it definitely has been easier in some senses. I've been doing I've been a full-time musician now for over 10 years, and you know, after the first 4 or 5 years, I managed to get regular bookings, and it never seemed to be a problem to find a gig, which was a really good position to be in. And then after a few years of sort of carrying on with that pattern, I finally did some traveling, and then it kind of reset from the beginning again. Nobody was really emailing me because I wasn't actually in Weston-super-Mare anymore. So starting from scratch teaches you to do everything again, and teaches you that you're able to do these things again. You don't have to rely on the position that you're in. If you lose everything, you can start again. That's what I'm trying
to
say.
Right. Yeah, that's quite a secure way to feel, isn't it? When you know you can create, you know, create income, create work for yourself, create success. Having that sense that if you lost it all or had to start again, you'd be okay. That's quite a, what do you call it, a secure kind of feeling, isn't it?
Well, yeah. I mean, I used to be afraid of turning down work in case, you know, it took a dip. But now I'm much different. Like I'll do guitar teaching solid for like 3 months, and then I'll have 2 months or 3 months break of that while I've got time then to update some of my lesson plans, and during that time I can do more gigs, and then, you know, I can dip in and out, and I can just choose what I want to do and when I want to do it, safe in the knowledge kind of that I can pick it back up again when I need to.
Yeah, that's awesome. So what's your I'm curious to ask you about the writing process, right? Because
songwriting,
I never really got it. I never got the knack of it. I don't know what it is. I don't know how it works, but I was never able to do it. I was an okay guitarist. I was like a lead rock kind of guitarist. I was sort of blues rock, and I was okay. I was good at playing covers, and I was good at performing and stuff, and I enjoyed that. But writing was just really elusive to me, and it was something I never managed to do. So can you give us some insight into your process?
I don't know really. It's, for me, it happens in lots of different ways. At the moment, I'm not super keen on like always trying to write something. The last time I wrote something, I was in where was I? I was in Fuerteventura. I was doing some gigs out there, And I just decided, right, these 2 weeks that I'm here, I'm going to spend my time going through all of these ideas that are on my laptop. And, you know, I've got a chunk of a verse here. I've got a bit of a sort of melody here that I like with bad words. I've got a guitar part that I like. And I just took all of these ideas and I just sat and I stuck with it until I had something. And that's what you really need to do. You've just got to get through that painful bit at the beginning where you think everything that you're doing is completely bland and just hope that by the time you've finished, it's kind of cohesive. And then once you've played it live a few times, then it starts to take shape. And my favorite part of writing a song is when you're in the studio and you've recorded the vocals and the guitar, then you get to put the stuff on top that you're not able to do yourself when you're writing it as such, you know, like the harmonies, you're adding these little guitar lines and you really start to flesh out the song itself. And then that's when I get really excited, like, oh, I love this song. I hope other people like it as well.
And right.
That's all you can ever wish for, you know. But writing songs, everybody does it differently. I think the best thing that I heard was from this documentary on the Eagles documentary, which if you haven't seen it, I really recommend it. It's on Netflix. And he was talking about the singer-songwriter who wrote Take It Easy. This guy, Jackson Browne, he wrote it for the band. And he used to live with him, and he just said that he would be in his bedroom and he would hear Jackson Browne play something on the piano, sing a little bit, you know, do that for 5-10 minutes. Then he'd go and make a cup of tea. Then he'd go back and he'd keep writing the same song and he'd keep going backwards and forwards. And he said, obviously, the secret to writing a good song is to just grind it out. Just keep on trying.
Right. Oh, I see. So it doesn't necessarily come easy. It doesn't necessarily come just straight away. You've got to work. You've got to like sculpt a song sometimes.
You really do. If a song comes out easily, then that's great. But I mean, in my experience, you could write a song quickly and you could like it, but then the next day you listen to it again, you go, it's really crap. You know, you have to trust that what you've written is going to be liked by somebody that's listening to it. You don't always like your own stuff.
And do you generally start with the lyrics and some kind of message that you want to express, or do you generally start with the musical side of it first?
It's happened in different ways. All of the ways you can think of, I think the easiest way is to start with a guitar part, and then you try and fit the words to match the rhythm of the guitar. That was the first way I used to write songs. I've tried it where I've written lyrics and then put the music around it. And then I found that I had to really, I didn't have to like be so, like formulaic with my words. You just write what you want to write, how you would speak it normally. And then you're forced to fit those words within a space that you're given. Or you can drag out one of the words or what, you know, and in that way, it forces you to be more experimental with the melody or the rhythm of where you're saying the words, but it's more conversational and more easy to what's the word, to relate to, I think. I don't know.
I see. So you don't have to be overly concerned about exactly how it's going to happen. You can kind of be a bit more fluid with how it comes together, can you?
Yeah, you can't be forgetting my words. You can't be so systematic about it. It's You've just got to sit there, do something that makes you feel good, record that little bit on your phone, and if you like it when you listen back to it, just keep building on it. And I don't know if there's anything else I can offer in that regards. I write quite frequently, but I'm not prolific like some people.
Yeah, I can kind of, when I teach handstands, sometimes I feel like the process of learning something new or teaching people is like demystifying it in a way, because I think sometimes when you come to learn a new skill and you've got all these ideas about what you think it, how it works, and I find a lot of people, they come and learn handstand and they've got like an overcomplicated idea of what they think they should be doing, and I feel like my job as a teacher is demystifying all the complications that are in their mind and just breaking it down to a few basic, you know, sort of exercises, you know, that they can,
absolutely,
that they feel is manageable. And I
completely agree with you. I mean, I'm a teacher as well, but with guitar. And actually, like, just over a year ago, I'd been teaching for many years in like schools and private teaching, and I never really had any system. They would turn up and I'd say, what would you like to learn? And I'd, you know, do things on the fly. And I decided if I'm going to get back into teaching that I want to do it, you know, properly, in inverted commas. So I designed a course that was to teach somebody who's never touched the guitar before in 8 weeks, just to be able to teach themselves something without a teacher. So it was like breaking down in each week all the little things that you need to be able to do, how you can read the things on the internet. And it's really fun. I love being a teacher now. And that exact thing that you said, where you've got to break it down into little sections, make it not only something that they can understand, but something that they can use for themselves in another context or something like that. It's great fun.
And where do you run that? Is it always in the same place, or do you do it around?
I do the lessons from home.
Okay.
I teach four people at a time. That's another skill that I didn't have before, you know, like four different people with four different levels of ability and four levels of understanding things. You've got to juggle it a little bit. You've got to make sure that it's not too easy, that the people who are finding it too easy are bored, and you've got to make it so it's not so challenging for the ones that are struggling. It's another reason why I love my job. It's awesome.
Right. Yeah, I can relate to that as well. Sometimes it's very random every time. Like sometimes people have come along to a workshop, and sometimes you've got a range of different abilities. You know, they've got quite advanced people, and then people that are completely starting from scratch. And I find that quite tricky to manage sometimes. I think I find it easier when everyone's of a similar ability. I find it easier to kind of lock in on, you know, to you know, it's easier to decide what activities to do. But I do enjoy the variety.
But what I tend to do in those sorts of situations, if there is somebody who's finding things, who's definitely been playing guitar a little bit longer, I just give them more workload. And then, like, if you were doing the handstand classes, I guess you could get some of the more advanced ones, or the ones who are finding it easier, to help support the ones who aren't. And then you don't have to have eyes on everybody. You know, you got them sort of helping this small group while you're doing this one. And everybody's still learning, but everyone's getting a little bit of what they want as well.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Besides music, what other hobbies or interests, you know, do you spend your time on?
I really don't have any. Like, if I go to Austria, for example, then I'll go skiing. If I'm in a hot country, I'll go to the beach and do all the like scuba diving bits, and whatever's in my area, I'll give it a try. But I don't really tend to do anything regularly. In Munich, where I live, it's just guitar teaching, gigging, or at the moment doing lots of sort of planning of videos that I'm planning to do in the future, and family things.
Yeah, right. How are you getting on in Munich? I mean, you've been there, what, how many years?
It's been just over 2 years, I think. Okay. Everything's going really cool. It started off tricky, obviously a new place, a new start. But the reason I moved here in the first place was I was traveling from 2013 to 2015, or the end of 2015. And every time I went back home at the time, which was Western, I just felt the traveling bug more and more and more. And I think I got an opportunity with my music in Germany, and I just thought, well, let's just do it. Let's just move out here and just see what happens. You never know. And then I moved out here. I did a 3 week camper van tour around Germany. It was pretty good fun seeing these new cities, playing in different venues. Got back to Munich, and then the people who offered me the opportunity said, oh, we can't give you this opportunity anymore. Good luck. Bye bye. So I put down the phone. I was like, can I swear?
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck am I going to do right now? I'm kind of in the middle of a new country. I didn't actually have anywhere to live at the time. And I just stayed with a friend and slowly just got myself together. And by the time I've been here after a year, I was fine. And I've been actually living in my new place now for about 6 or 7 months. And everything was cool. I'm happy. I'm making a living from music, so I couldn't really be happier. It's all I ever really wanted, so it's all good, man.
Yeah, that's great. I'm curious, what's your medium to long term sort of vision for your musical career? Where do you want to be in like 5 or 10 years?
That's a good question. I don't really have a clear idea, and I think that's something that I need to work on. All I really ever wanted a few years ago was to be able to play my music around the world, and I'm actually able to do that now. I'm playing a lot of cover music as well, and when I do play my own music, it's not to an audience of people who've come to listen to that original music, which is something that I would really like moving forward. But you've got to grow your fan base online. You've got to go to these places. You've got to do an awful lot to get people to find what you're doing interesting. And it's just hard work.
Yeah.
At the moment, all I want to do is record these new songs I have to the best of my ability, see if people like them. And it's an awful lot of promotion to do. But in the long run, I mean, if I just did what I'm doing now for another 10, 20 years, I'd still be happy.
Right. That's fine. That's great. So you've got a high degree of contentment and sort of fulfillment from what you're currently doing by the sound of it.
Yeah, I am content. And you can always want more. But I think it's also important to recognize that, you know, you've reached a certain point where all the things that you were asking for, you've got them. And it's not a bad thing to stay kind of on a plateau when it's a good one, I guess.
Yeah. The I'm a little hesitant to ask you about that challenge you were doing some years ago, because I wonder whether you might be sort of fed up with talking about it by now. But the people listening might not know anything about that. So can you summarize it?
Which challenge are you referring to?
You did like the 100 challenge.
Oh, right. Okay. I'm happy to talk about that. That's not a problem. Basically, when I was in Australia, I had this weird epiphany. Like, I was in the country I'd always wanted to visit. I was there to play some music, so I was there doing exactly what I wanted to do. And for some reason, I was not fulfilled. There was something missing, and I couldn't figure out what it was. I just felt like depressed and bored. I was like, dude, sort yourself out. And I looked up and I asked the universe to give me a little bit of guidance, because I believe in the universe, if not anything. And a couple of days later, I walked past a bookshelf, and there was one on there that really jumped out at me, and it was called 100 Things, and it's written by a guy called Sebastian Terry. I read the book, and it's about his story of writing down everything he wanted to do with his life, and he just packed a bag and went and did them. And I was just like, that's amazing. Why doesn't everybody do that? You know,
yeah.
That's what your life's for, isn't it? You know, so I spent the next few days just writing down everything that came to my mind, what I wanted to do. Came up with 100 things, and I booked some tickets to go to the Faroe Islands shortly after to go and see the total eclipse that was happening at the time. I think it was at the big middle of 2013. I'm not 100% sure. Maybe 2014. At the moment, I'm not really doing anything on the list, because I got about 30 things through, ticked off 30 things, and I just kind of stopped. I just thought, well, I'm all right for a minute. There's nothing on there that I'm desperate to do. I can always change the list or look at it later when I feel like it.
Give us a couple of the most memorable ones that was your favorite ones.
Well, the most memorable one was probably walking 500 miles. I walked from a place called Irun on the border between France and Spain, walked to Santiago de Compostela, which was part of the Camino route. And I was basically walking an average of 27 kilometers a day for 32 days. And it was amazing. I'm not a walker. Like, anyone who knew me just laughed and said, you're never going to be able to do this. And I did. It was just cool. Met so many cool people along the way. And I got a really good feeling about what it is I want from life. And when you take away every distraction, and the only things that you have to worry about is getting to the next hostel to be able to sleep and finding some food, your brain has lots of time to sort of digest what you're doing, where you are in life, what you want to do next, and you get to really enjoy the company of the people that you're with. It was a very eye-opening experience, and if somebody's listening to this and they're thinking of doing a Camino, I would definitely recommend it. But I think it's something that you should do in the time that feels right for you. Don't just like leave tomorrow because I'm telling you to or anyone tells you to. It will find you at the right time, I think.
Mm. Hey, whenever I listen to interviews, I often hear them ask the question, what would you tell your younger self? So I want to ask you that, but I'm thinking like in terms of the younger musician, in terms of like music and the music industry, what would you tell the younger, your younger self who's just starting out?
That's a hard one. I guess I'd tell him just keep doing what you're doing and you will get a little better, don't worry. I always felt kind of I've really felt like I was lacking in skill. I don't think anyone really ever gets over that, but I got to a place where I felt like I wanted to be. So I tell him just do what you want to do and it will be fine.
Right. So, okay. Also, same question with regards to romance and women relating, you know, relationships. What would you tell your younger self with regards to that?
I don't know.
I'm asking for a friend.
I don't think there's a secret to it, man. You meet people along the way and you get really good connections with them. Sometimes it doesn't last forever, but the connections that you get at those times are not any less valuable. I still think about past relationships, and I think very highly of these people. And you know, your life is a crisscross of meeting people and learning from them in different ways. Relationships that are romantic or just normal relationships, I think they're all there for a reason, you know. And I don't think it's such a bad thing that, you know, when somebody outgrows somebody else, that you just part ways and you be grateful for the time that you did have.
Mm. Yes, that's a very positive and wise view of it. That's great. Where can people find you? Like website and all that?
Yeah, well, I mean, the best place to find me is on Facebook. They can go to my Facebook page, which is Ryan AO Inglis Music, all one word. I'm at the moment, I'm doing like a radio show of my own on Monday nights. I'm doing one tonight from 6:30 UK time, 7:30 Germany time. And Thursday nights I do a live, I sing and play my guitar live on Thursday evenings on Facebook Live as well. If they want to find me physically, then they got to come to Munich and they got to buy me a beer, and that's all.
Who is the last kind of big concert that you went to see?
The last concert?
Yeah.
Wow, my mind's just gone blank. Who did I see last? I don't know. You put me on the spot there.
Okay. Who's your favorite live that you've seen?
Well, there's two artists really, John Mayer and Radiohead. I think I've seen them more than any other acts, but I don't go to enough live gigs. Every time I go to a live gig, I always come away thinking, oh, that's so awesome. That's what I want to do. Oh, the last band I saw, it was the Coronas, and it was in Dublin. I bought some tickets to take my girlfriend there because this is all soppy and stuff, but when we first met, one of the first songs that she ever played me was this song from the Coronas. So for her Christmas present, I bought her some tickets. And we went, and it was really, really awesome. You know, they're not a very, very well-known band, but they're playing to audiences of 20, maybe 30,000 tops. And that's a good level. I mean, to reach that is amazing. And they were fantastic live, good songs. Yeah, really, really cool.
So what's your immediate projects just over the next week or 2 weeks? Like what are you immediately focused on?
Immediately. Well, like I said, my guitar lessons are all coming to an end. I'll start up again in spring. So the next 2 weeks, God, I don't think I'm doing anything stressful. I think I'm just going to relax. Got Christmas coming up. So, strenuous. Nothing strenuous.
That's great. You seem to have a nice balance and a nice balanced outlook that's not too sort of extreme in any direction, which is nice, I think.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Well, thanks for joining us, Ryan. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for asking me, man. It's nice to speak to you, and I hope that you are also very well. And yeah, keep on doing what you're doing. It's very inspiring to see what you're capable of. It's very cool.
Oh, glad you think so. Yeah, cool. All right, we'll leave it there. Thanks for your time and all the best, and speak to you soon.
All the best to you, man. Take it
Cheers,
easy.
buddy. Bye.
Bye bye.